Thanks, Darren. I am, in fact, from Ithaca. It's great to be home. One thing I didn't anticipate, though, is I actually had my bar mitzvah reception in this building. So if I break into Hebrew, correct me, okay? So bring back odd memory. Now, the last time I was in this building was my freaking bar mitzvah. So as Darren said, what I'm basically going to do today is summarize this book on party building. Political scientists continue to pretty much converge around the idea that strong political parties are essential to both the quality and the stability of democracy. When political parties are weak, a range of studies have shown you're more likely to see governability crises, you're more likely to see executive abuse of power, you're more likely to see ineffective government, and the rise of anti-democratic outsiders, although we now know that can happen within established parties as well. Yet, as Dan mentioned, strong parties have proven hard to come by in Latin America. For the last three decades, nearly four decades, established parties have either weakened significantly or collapsed in Argentina, in Bolivia, in Colombia, Costa Rica, Ecuador, Guatemala, Panama, Peru, Venezuela. And for the most part, with a couple of exceptions, the parties that replaced declining or collapsed parties have been much weaker and much more ephemeral, leaving Latin American party systems, most Latin American party systems, in much worse shape than they were, or in worse shape than they were 30, 35 years ago. But party weakness has not been completely universal. A handful of new parties have, in fact, emerged and taken root in Latin America since the onset of the third wave of democratization. Now, we score, let me see if I can get this down, right? We score a new party as successfully taking root when it wins at least 10% of the vote in five consecutive national legislative elections. That's a pretty high bar, higher bar than most people use, but I think it captures institutionalization, allows us to weed out flash parties like Frepaso in Argentina. So here we are, the 11 parties have taken roots in 78, PT, PSDB, and PFL in Brazil, Arena and FMLN in El Salvador, UDI, Renovación Nacional, and the PPD in Chile, the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, the PRD in Mexico, and the PRD in Panama. Now, these success cases represent a very small fraction of the universe of new parties in Latin America. We compiled a list of all 307 parties that emerged in 18 Latin American countries between 1978 and 2005, and which won at least 1% of the national vote. So all the new parties that were formed and managed to win 1% of the vote, we listed. And of these, 244 failed outright. They failed in one of three ways. They either never reached 10% of the vote and then died, what are called flops. They won 10% of the vote and then collapsed. They were flash parties. Or they survived, but they never reached 10% of the vote, which means they remained marginal parties. Another 52, the jury's still out. Their score is incomplete because they have yet to compete in five consecutive elections. But of these, it's pretty clear that only a handful are likely to take root. So these include probably Chavismo in Venezuela, probably Fujimorismo in Peru, which I'll talk about later, probably the MAS in Bolivia, maybe the Citizens Action Party in Costa Rica. But beyond that, there are very few parties in this group of 52 incompletes that are likely to take root. So it doesn't seem like the pattern is changing much. That means that approximately 4% of the new parties created since 1978 have taken root, which means that party building still happens in Latin America, but is a pretty rare event. And the book basically tries to explain this rare event. Others, we try to identify the conditions under which successful party building is more or less likely to happen. Now, a lot of the literature from both within and outside Latin America essentially expects party building to occur more or less automatically under democracy, under stable democratic conditions. For example, in a classic work, John Aldrich argues that individual politicians in democracies have an incentive to, unquote, turn to parties in order to achieve collective goals, like winning elections, like passing legislation, that increase the likelihood of sustaining a political career. So politicians under democracy should have an incentive to coordinate and form parties. Other scholars have a more bottom-up approach, still focusing on democracy and democratic competition. Scholars going back to Converse and Campbell have argued that the process of voting in repeating elections leads citizens to develop partisan attachments, so that over time, competitive elections, if they persist, should yield stable partisan identities and should yield stable parties. The empirical record in Latin America makes pretty clear that democracy and elections are not sufficient to generate robust parties. Nearly four decades since the onset of the third wave, new parties, again, have taken root in only a handful of Latin American countries. And in fact, only one of our 11 successful cases, Brazil's Social Democratic Party, was actually born under democracy. The other 10 all emerged either under authoritarianism or during transitions from authoritarian rule. So outside of Brazil, no successful party building has occurred in Latin American democracies between 1978 and 2005. None. So democracy doesn't give rise to strong parties. What does? In the book, we go through a bunch of other alternative explanations. I don't have time for that here. To begin with, we argue that new parties have to do two things in order to take root. First of all, they've got to cultivate strong partisan identities. Successful parties need partisans. They need a base of individuals who have a strong attachment to that party and who consistently turn out to vote for it. Noam Rupel argues, and he has a chapter in our book, that the key to stable partisanship lies in developing a clear brand. Parties with strong brands are parties that stand for something in the eyes of their voters, something that that voters identify with. According to Lupu, two things are essential to brand development: differentiation and consistency. In other words, new parties have to distinguish themselves, have to differentiate themselves from others, and their behavior needs to be consistent over time. Their programmatic behavior has to be consistent over time. If a new party is indistinguishable from other parties, or if its profile changes dramatically from one election to the next, its brand is likely to be diluted, and at least for Lupu, it's unlikely to take root. So a partisan base is critical. Second thing, arguably more important, is territorial organization. Grassroots organizations do a bunch of things for parties, even today in a world of mass media technology. They help parties disseminate their brand. I think the Democratic Party in the heartland of the United States is now realizing that party organization, or that organization, matters. Organizations help parties distribute. They help them build and sustain clientelist networks, which is very important. And crucially, they help to mobilize voters. Organizations also help parties endure over time, particularly endure despite hard times, because they create essentially a class of activists who have a stake in the organization's survival. And that allows new parties that fail, new parties that have a really bad election, that make a really bad decision, to survive to play another day, whether it's the PRD in Mexico, the FMLN in El Salvador, or the PT in Brazil. Parties that lack any organization, or new parties that lack any organization, are much more likely to flat out disappear if they make mistakes. And Frepaso in Argentina is a great example of that. In fact, nearly all of the new parties that took root in Latin America over the last 30 years built strong grassroots organizations. The PPD in Chile is one striking example. And I can't quite explain the success of the PPD in Chile. Maybe Ken can help us. Okay, so need to develop a brand and need to build an organization. Both of those things, brand development and organization building, were particularly tough in contemporary Latin America, were tough to do, were unlikely events in the last 30 or 40 years in Latin America. Take brand development. The 1980s and 1990s were a period of severe economic crisis and radical neoliberal reform. So the so-called Washington Consensus induced a wide range of statist and left-of-center parties to essentially abandon their programs in favor of neoliberalism. This is what Ken's last book is about. As a result, relatively few, but there are some, but relatively few parties were able to maintain the programmatic differentiation and the programmatic consistency that Lupu argues is critical for brand development. So parties like Frepaso in Argentina, the MIR in Bolivia, the Democratic Left in Ecuador, Christian Democrats in El Salvador and Guatemala, badly diluted their brands in the 1980s and 90s and collapsed as a result. Organization building also proved really tough in the last 30 or 40 years. Organization building, I don't know how many of you have tried it, difficult, time-consuming, costly process. And for that reason, politicians who can win and who can maintain office via some other way while avoiding investing in parties and organizations are likely to do so. And in the era of mass media technology, politicians in it have been able to do just that. So parties, again, like Frepaso in Argentina, Peru Posible in Peru, the M19 in Colombia, the PPD in Chile, Alianza País, at least until recently in Ecuador, all of them found that it was easier and much more effective to use mass media to appeal to voters to win and retain office than, and that they did not need to invest in party organization. So under ordinary democratic conditions in contemporary Latin America, Latin American politicians lack a strong incentive to invest in party building. And what you need then for organization building is extraordinary conditions. It's periods, we argue, of intense, often violent conflict that generates the partisan attachments, that generates the organizations that enable new parties to take root. So I'm talking about periods of revolutionary and or counter-revolutionary violence, civil war, periods of mass populist mobilization and counter-mobilization, periods of authoritarian repression. Polarization and conflict contributes to party building in several ways. First of all, it clearly strengthens partisan attachments. Intense conflict, particularly violent conflict, tends to generate enduring political identities. Civil wars, like those of 19th century Colombia and Uruguay, 20th century El Salvador, revolutions like Mexico and Nicaragua, sharply divide societies in ways that very often crystallize partisan identities. Experiences of violent conflict often generate bind people to parties for life, and identities that in many cases are passed on to children and grandchildren. These are people who have experienced violent conflict who cannot even imagine voting for another political party. In Argentina, if you ask an older Peronist why they're voting Peronist, they won't say, "I'm voting Peronist." They'll say, "I am Peronist." They'll say, "They are Peronist. They were born Peronist. Peronism is in their blood." I once asked a Catholic Peronist, tell me, "I love Peronism as much as I love God." And then he thought about it for a second and said, "Or more." That kind of partisan attachment doesn't come from a simple act of voting. It surely is not a product of politicians overcoming coordination problems. It comes from periods of intense polarization and conflict. So one thing conflict does is generate strong partisan attachments. The other thing it does is encourage organization building. Politicians, and Ken has worked on this as well, have a much stronger incentive to invest in an organization when their goals extend beyond elections. That's the case with guerrilla movements like the Sandinistas and the FMLN. It's also the case with conservative parties facing an often existential leftist threat, like Arena in El Salvador and UDI in Chile. And crucially, and I think this has been understudied, conflict mobilizes activists. Grassroots organizations at root are networks of activists. They're human beings. Established party machines can rely on paid activists. They can rely on public employees to do party work. But new parties need to have volunteer activists to build their organizations. Without hundreds, thousands of human beings, you cannot build a grass organization. Again, organization building is hard work. Most people don't want to do it. Most people don't want to spend time building a party organization. It's only the most insane, deranged, or ideologically committed activists who are willing to put in the time, the energy, sometimes the risk to do it. Committed activists need a higher cause. Revolutionary movements, counter-revolutionary movements, civil wars, independence struggles, mass populist movements, anti-authoritarian struggles. Without a cause like that, you very rarely mobilize large numbers of committed activists. And without large numbers of committed activists, you can't get a grassroots organization. Conflict has long been a source or a primary source of party building in Latin America. Many of the region's most historically successful and enduring parties were born or consolidated during periods of violent conflict. So the traditional parties in Colombia, in Uruguay, to a lesser extent Costa Rica and Honduras, were born of civil war. The Mexican PRI emerged out of violent revolution. Major parties like the MNR in Bolivia, the radicals and Peronists in Argentina, AD in Venezuela, APRA in Peru, the PAN in Mexico, the Dominican PRD, the Broad Front in Uruguay, all of them took root during periods of intense polarization and or repression. Same thing in the contemporary period. Polarization and conflict gave rise to the bulk of the successful new parties today in Latin America. Three of our 11 cases of success, the FMLN and ARENA in El Salvador, the FSLN in Nicaragua, emerged out of civil war or revolution. Three other successful left parties, the PT, the PRD in Mexico, and the PPD in Chile, were born in opposition to authoritarian rule, and their formative periods were shaped by intense polarization, protest, and repression. The other end of the spectrum, the UDI in Chile, was a reaction to what appeared to be an existential Marxist threat in the context of polarization in Pinochet's Chile. Now, conflict, first of all, is neither necessary nor sufficient for successful party building. It's an important contributing factor. There is a shortcut, though, and that is what we call organizational inheritance. If you can manage to inherit a brand and an organization, it dramatically reduces the costs of party building. And we identify in the book four pretty important sources of organizational inheritance. Probably the most important is authoritarianism. As James Loxton shows in the book and in his own work, authoritarian successor parties, parties that are built out of the rubble of pre-existing authoritarian regimes, have several built-in advantages in building a party. For one, they tend to have an established brand and a pretty solid base of support. It may be 15, 20, 25% of the electorate, but that is a pretty important floor to begin with. Authoritarian successor parties can also usually tap into pre-existing patronage or clientelist networks from the old regime, so they don't have to build organizations from scratch. They have activist networks that they can stitch together. And many of them have pretty close ties to business elites that thrived under the old regime and that can be a key source of finance. Of our 11 success cases, five were authoritarian successor parties: UDI, ARENA, Sandinistas, the PFL in Brazil, the PRD in Panama. Another path, a little less common in Latin America, but to organizational inheritance is guerrilla organization, guerrilla movements. And this is the topic of Alicia Holland's chapter in the volume. Like authoritarian successor parties, insurgent successor parties have ready-made brands. They've got solid partisan support bases, and they've got ready-made activist networks they can build upon. Revolutionary brands are polarizing, which can be an obstacle to winning elections, but they provide ready-made brand differentiation, which is crucial. Two of our 11 success cases, the Sandinistas and the FMLN, are insurgent successor parties. A third source of organizational inheritance is social movements. As Raul Madrid's chapter in the volume shows, the most successful indigenous parties to emerge in the 1990s and 2000s were those that were built upon pre-existing indigenous movements, indigenous organizations. This was the case to varying degrees in MAS in Bolivia and Pachakutik in Ecuador. And finally, in a really interesting chapter, Will Barnt argues that large private firms can provide an infrastructure for party building as well. Corporations, certain kinds of corporations, can provide parties not only with finance, but with physical infrastructure and with personnel, literally the firm's employees. And so you see this really interestingly in Ricardo Martinelli's Democratic Change Party in Panama, also with Cesar Acuña's Alliance for Progress Party in Peru, which was based, the Martinelli's party was based on a chain of supermarkets, and Acuña's party was based on a chain of private universities, which were deployed for party building. No corporation-based party has yet crossed our threshold for success, so it's kind of too early to tell. But this form of party building seems to be on the rise, and certainly it is in Peru, where at the provincial and regional level, there are dozens of these parties. So to sum up the argument, we identify two critical conditions for successful party building in the contemporary period: periods of intense, often violent conflict, and some kind of organizational inheritance. And here, okay, so that's the distribution of cases, and yes, I'm not normally a PowerPoint guy, but I had to do it today. We score 11 cases here on both on the conditions under which they emerge and whether or not they benefit from organizational inheritance. Note that only one of the parties emerges under democracy, PSDB in Brazil. By contrast, three successful parties emerged in the context of civil war or insurgency, and seven emerged either under dictatorship or during transitions from authoritarian rule. Of the seven parties that emerged under dictatorship, five of them emerged under bureaucratic authoritarianism, a regime type that is characterized by high levels of polarization and repression. In terms of organizational inheritance, six of 11 are authoritarian successor parties, two are insurgent successor parties, and two are built upon social movements. Only the PSDB in Brazil and the PPD in Chile lacked a clear organizational inheritance. All right, now this table presents data on the birth conditions of the full universe of parties. So between 1978 and 2005, Latin American countries, excluding Cuba, collectively spent 318 years under electoral democracy. They spent 90 years under authoritarianism, 41 of which are bureaucratic authoritarianism, and 78 years under civil war or major insurgency. Amazingly, 318 country years of democracy produced one successful party. 78 years of civil war and insurgency gave rise to three. 90 years of authoritarianism produced seven successful parties. And the ratio is even higher for bureaucratic authoritarians. All right, I want to, here's my friend Keiko. Spend a few minutes talking about the case of Fujimorismo in Peru, which is a great case. Fujimorismo is an incredibly unlikely case of party building. Peru is an extreme case of party system collapse. All major parties collapsed during the 1990s, and there's been very little party rebuilding since then. Peru's been a party-building desert for the last quarter of a century. In fact, all new parties that have been formed over the last two decades, since the mid-1990s, have collapsed or gone into significant decline, including the parties that won the presidency in 2001 and 2011. So does not appear to be a particularly favorable environment for party building. And what's more, the founding leader of Fujimorismo, Alberto Fujimori, is in prison today, was about as anti-party a character as you can imagine. He never invested in a party. He, in fact, created and discarded four different political parties during his presidency. And Fujimori's daughter, Keiko, up here, my friend, who now leads the party, told me, and this is a quote from her, she said, "My father doesn't believe in parties. He, like a good caudillo, he does not like to cede power. To build a party organization, you have to cede power." So she openly recognized that her father had no interest in parties at all. But to everybody's surprise, Fujimorismo has emerged as the strongest political party in Peru, with a pretty good likelihood of institutionalizing. After nearly collapsing in the wake of Fujimori's fall in 2000, the party came back, won 13% of the legislative vote in 2006. It won 23% of the legislative vote in 2011. And 2016 won 36% of the legislative vote, which gave it an absolute majority in Congress and brought Keiko Fujimori within a half an inch of the presidency. Fujimorismo now is clearly the best organized party in the country. It's also clearly got the largest partisan base. According to a study by Carlos Melendez a couple years ago, 16% of Peruvian voters identify as Fujimorista, and that easily exceeds that of all other parties, including APRA, historically the largest party in the country. So Fujimorismo hasn't yet reached our threshold for success, but it stands a pretty good chance of doing it. The question is, how did this happen? How could a makeshift personalistic vehicle in a country dominated by makeshift personalistic vehicles actually take root as a party? I want to highlight two factors. First of all, Fujimorismo is an authoritarian successor party. Fujimori did not build a party, but his regime left behind several legacies that proved useful for party building. One of them was an established brand. We were talking about this at breakfast, why Peruvians would vote for Keiko Fujimori. Due to Fujimori government's success in stabilizing the economy, ending hyperinflation, and in particular defeating the Shining Path, Fujimori retained considerable public support throughout his presidency and even after his pretty disgraceful fall from power. So in a 2006 survey, which is 2006 is the year that Fujimori was extradited and put on trial for large-scale human rights violations and corruption, 48% of respondents in a survey expressed a positive view of his presidency. There have been a series of polls that show similar results. So there were a lot of potential Fujimorista voters out there. and Fujimori's most stood for something, particularly law and order. The Fujimori government also left behind loose but pretty well-organized clientelist networks. These networks had emerged around politicized social programs that channeled resources through soup kitchens and neighborhood associations, particularly in urban popular districts around Lima. Many of those soup kitchens and neighborhood associations persisted well into the 2000s, and many of their leaders, the activists who ran them, remained Fujimorista, and that provided Fujimorismo with an organized presence in the popular sectors that no other party had, and gave them a base upon which to rebuild their party. And they very self-consciously did that in the second half of the first decade of the 2000s. Finally, Fujimorismo maintained ties to a set of business people who did very well under the Fujimori government. And those guys became critical sources of finance for the party. So drawing on the resources generated by the previous authoritarian regime was critical. But the other factor that facilitated Fujimorismo's resurgence and potential reconsolidation was polarization and conflict. I think this has been underappreciated in Peru. Fujimorismo was powerfully shaped, first of all, by the counterinsurgency against the Shining Path in the 1990s. A large number of Fujimorismo's lower and middle level cadres are former police, former military, who viewed themselves as fighting a war and winning a war, saving the patria in the 1990s. These guys viewed themselves as being at war. But it wasn't just the 90s. The 2000 transition triggered another round of polarization and conflict. Not violent conflict, but pretty intense polarization. The human rights investigations, the human rights trials of the early 2000s invariably targeted Fujimoristas. So more than 200 Fujimorista officials were prosecuted, in most cases quite rightly, for corruption and human rights violations in the first half of the 2000s. Three prominent Fujimorista leaders were expelled from Congress. And of course, Fujimori himself was tried and convicted and imprisoned in 2007. We may see this as transitional justice, and I think it was transitional justice. But the Fujimoristas, to a person, view this and call this the period of persecution, an era of persecution. And that shared perception of persecution helped to unify and to revitalize Fujimoristas. One Fujimorista leader put it to me, there is no better glue for a political movement than a feeling of injustice. We were like Christians in Rome. So Fujimorismo reemerges in the early 2000s as a social movement seeking to bring Fujimori back from exile, kind of like the Peronists did in the 60s in Argentina. It mobilized against human rights trials. It mobilized against other mechanisms of transitional justice, particularly and culminating in Fujimori's trial in 2006 and 7. The movement was never very big, but it developed a pretty strong identity, a pretty strong subculture. And so when the party jumped seriously back into electoral politics, particularly after 2006, it had an established brand, it had a committed activist base, and it had at least some infrastructure to build upon. Also, it turned out to have a pretty strong candidate in Keiko Fujimori, which helps. So we propose a conflict-centered approach to party building by strengthening partisan attachments, by forcing elites, or at least inducing elites, to invest in an organization, by mobilizing activists on a relatively large scale. Periods, particularly extensive periods, of polarization and conflict create conditions that are much more favorable for party building than those generated by democratic institutions by themselves. And I think a conflict-centered approach helps us to understand why successful party building has been so uncommon in contemporary Latin America. Latin America has been mostly democratic since the 1980s, and most of the region's civil wars ended by the early 1990s. With the end of the Cold War in particular, starting in around 1990, left-right polarization diminished considerably across much of the region. Now, in most respects, democratization, peace, depolarization were desirable developments, but they probably inhibited party building. Now, Bolivia and Venezuela are exceptions to this pattern. Both countries experienced intense polarization, intense mobilization, and conflict in the 2000s. And I think it's not coincidental that both countries saw the emergence of what are likely to be enduring political parties, Chavismo in Venezuela and the MAS in Bolivia. All right. I want to just close by highlighting two paradoxes of party building, and at the risk of being redundant. First is a paradox of democracy. We find that even though political parties are critical to democratic stability, stable democracy, in fact, does not create very favorable conditions for party building. Robust parties are much more likely to emerge under authoritarian rule or in contexts like civil war or intense polarization that can threaten existing democracies. So it's when democracies are in trouble or non-existent that you get more favorable conditions for party building. The second paradox is paradox of populism. Populism is widely viewed, at least by many scholars, as inimical to party building. Populists are said to be personalistic, they're said to be anti-institutional, they're said to make explicitly anti-party appeals. And in fact, rarely do particularly contemporary party populist leaders take party building very seriously. In fact, many of them engage in much more party destruction than they do party building. I guess Perón and Fujimori are classic examples of this. Yet if populists weaken parties in the short term, they may, albeit unintentionally and indirectly, strengthen them in the long term. Successful populism invariably polarizes societies, and in many cases it generates pretty sustained social and political conflict. Populists like Perón, Aya, Chavez, Fujimori earned intense popular sector support while at the same time triggering intense elite opposition. And the result was prolonged, in some cases, violent conflict between populist and anti-populist forces, which generated pretty strong political identities and in many cases incentives to build organizations. So though populist experiences don't immediately give rise to strong parties, in fact may immediately weaken parties, they may create the raw materials for party building down the road. Intense polarization, again, tends to produce clear brands, tends to produce stronger partisan identities, tends to produce, in most cases, pretty large activist bases that even if they're initially organized into some kind of loosely defined movement that refuses to call itself a party, provides a foundation in the medium run for a pretty robust partisan organization. Peronism is a case of this. Chavismo is likely to be a case of this. I think Fujimorismo is a case of this. That's all I got, but I'd be happy to take feedback and questions.